Would you please stand? We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Please do sit down. We have come here today to remember before God our brother Roger William Buck. We are here to give thanks for Roger's life, for all that he did, and all that he meant to us and to many others, and all that he will continue to mean. We are here to entrust Roger to the care of God, our Maker and Redeemer, and afterwards to take his body for cremation. We are here to comfort one another in our grief, in the hope that death is not the end, but the beginning of Roger's new and fuller life. It is my very great privilege and sadness to welcome you here this morning, as all of us, in such wonderful number, come to say thank you for the gift that Roger was and is to us. You will all know that you could be completely blunt with Roger, and when he and I began to discuss his funeral, I said to him, "You know there will be lots of people there," and he grinned. "You know there will be lots of clergy there, only to make sure I've gone," he said. Indeed, 10 clergy would seem more than enough supervision for one churchwarden. But all of us today are here united in our grief and our great, great thanksgiving for the gift Roger was to all of us. We come to surround Lorna and Amy and Judy and all the family with our love and our prayer. So let us pray. God of all consolation, your Son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on us, your children, in our loss. Give to our troubled hearts the light of hope and strengthen in us the gift of faith through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Roger chose the hymns for today's service himself, so as we begin this time of thanksgiving, we stand to sing "Just As I Am."
Would you sit down, please? We're going to hear the first of several tributes now. It's from Chris Hargest, who for the last few years has served as church warden here at St. Nicholas, along with Roger.
This is something that I never thought I'd be standing here before you doing this. For when I was asked to say a few words about Roger today, I was worried. What could I say about this great friend? How can I do this? Can I really do this? Then I remembered what Roger used to say when we had something difficult to do. He'd say, "Don't worry, mate, just let it go over your head, it'll be all right." And it was. So here we are, and I hope this will be all right, Roger. Before I became churchwarden, I used to watch Roger getting things done calmly, efficiently, and I admired him so much. So, when a vacancy came up for another church warden, he asked me if I would take it on. Well, I must say that I was not really ready for doing that, so I thought. Then I said, "Yeah, I'll do it. If only he would stay on and work with me." He agreed, great to my satisfaction. So it was the two of us. Roger, in his usual calm, settled way, showed me what to do, told me what to do, and I learnt from Roger. We didn't know each other too well at that time, but the time after our first job together, which was cutting the vicarage garden and trimming it ready for the next vicar to arrive, we cut the vicar's grass, and I can honestly say I had a day and a half of laughing. And if that vicarage lawn wanted straight lines, and I had the mower, it never got straight lines. We had such fun. And from then on, it was just Roger and me, and we clicked. And Roger's sense of humour, as you probably know, was brilliant. And his one-liners, but you can remember them, can't you? Every now and then, in the middle of a sentence, he'd say something. His one-liners are so quick, I could hardly keep up, and I'm still trying. I'm trying to work them out still. One of the things that usually we did, and it got to be a habit, and I'm sure you all know what it is, I would say, "Are you going to do the candles today, Roger?" He'd say, "How many do you want?" I said, "Four." "You want four candles?" He said, "No, handles for forks." And that was every Sunday morning that went on. There is hardly anything at all in this church that Roger has neither cleaned, looked after, or arranged to be fixed. And if we couldn't fix it, Roger knew somebody who could, and it got it done. So, you know, all the chuckles that we had, and we did have quite a few chuckles while we were working. I think some of the congregation here, and they know who they are, called us the Chuckle Brothers. And we did a lot of that. We did a lot of chuckling. Roger. My friend Roger touched my heart. And he will remain in it forever. And as I look around all the people and all of you gathered here, I am sure that he touched your hearts. I thank God that I was able to get to know him and to realize what a special person he was. God bless you, Roger Buck. I hope you get a nice warm cloud to rest on and a pool table, quite Buzz. Thank you.
And now Judy and Amy will pay tribute to their dad. They'll share some reflections, and Judy will conclude this part of the service by reading a short poem.
Amy and I are going to say a few words about our wonderful dad, husband to Lorna, granddad Rog to Isaac and Jacob, brother to Sylvia, father-in-law to Luke and Sean, and friend to many. Firstly, Mum, Amy and myself would like to thank everyone who has sent well wishes, cards and flowers. We are so grateful for the support we have received at this very difficult time. We would also like to thank David and the congregation of St. Nicholas Church, who have all helped us to organise the celebration of Dad today. We would also like to thank Chris and all at Murrell Corks, who have treated us with such compassion. Our thanks to also to Rob and Martin, who are very kindly in assisting us with food for the church and also at the KA. Everyone is welcome to join us at both places, and we will be toasting to Dad later at the KA.
We would like to start by saying we really had the best dad ever. If you could write down a description of the perfect dad, it would be him. Dad was always there for us. He would pick us up at all hours when Judy and I were a bit worse for wear. He would also listen and try to help us. He helped us with many DIY tasks in our house, but most of all, his love for us was always there. Dad was not always there for us, but his family, friends, and the community. Nothing was ever too much trouble, and he would often carry out many kind deeds without saying a word to anyone. Dad was also a fantastic granddad and would never hesitate in spending time with Isaac and Jacob. He spent many hours walking Isaac when he was a baby while I worked. Isaac wanted me to say how much he loved granddad and he misses your hugs and you come to watch him play football.
Dad was born in Edingthorpe on the 7th of April 1948. He was born to Dad Richard and Mum Doris and his sister Sylvia. Dad was raised in Acton and had kept in contact with friends from his childhood. One childhood friend, MP Gillian Shepherd, organised a trip for the Acton Bunch to look around Parliament, and he had a fantastic day. Mum and Dad knew each other for most of their lives, enjoyed music at local venues. Dad would get a lift to North Walsham with Gerald Wilde and go and see Mum, or he would bike. One day he even biked into a snowdrift. Dad worked at Russ's grocery store, and when he passed his driving test, he went to do deliveries for them. Dad also did some work for Grimsby's on a building site and then worked for Pardons doing grass cutting. This work led to Bacton Gas Site Terminal for many years, working at Phillips with the likes of Bimbo, Tid and Pat. Dad then helped Mum with her gardening business, also delivering Majestic wine. This was our favourite job of Dad's, as we kept a good supply of wine. Later in Dad's life, he enjoyed watching football, his teams being Newcastle and Norwich. He always enjoyed playing darts and pool for the King's Arms. Dad would regularly be seen having coffee in town with Mum.
Judy and I were so lucky to have a fantastic childhood, and we had so many days out. Days out would include Great Yarmouth, Pleasurewood Hills, Wally's Windmill and Splash. We would regularly have friends over at the weekends, and they were always invited on these days out and treated exactly the same as us. Saturday nights would always include a trip to Woolies for pick and mix, or over to the shop for sweets, and our friend also getting sweets too when they were round. Sundays usually involved the left and right game whilst out for a drive. We loved it, and Dad always knew his way around and secretly knew where we were at all times. As you know, Dad loved a joke. This continued when he was poorly, and one night, while sat watching curry with Mum and I asked Dad, "Dad, what is your favourite soap?" And he replied, "Olive." Dad's sayings were something he used at regular intervals all through the day in his life. These would include, "Seven," "Hey," every time we mentioned getting these for our pets. Another one was, "Yo, Billy," he used to say that all the time, and "Hit that minty highway, Norman." Dad also enjoyed the Taken movies, which we watched a lot together, and he would regularly do an impression of the Russian criminal, "Good luck." One thing that was very important to Dad was his love of peas, and I will leave that thought with you.
I'm going to read a poem now. "He Only Takes the Best." God saw that he was getting tired, a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around him and whispered, "Come with me." With tearful eyes, we watched him suffer and saw him fade away. Although we loved him dearly, we could not make him stay. A golden heart stopped beating, hard-working hands to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best.
With all those wonderful words of tribute and with our own memories, we're now going to listen to the music, Islands in the Stream. Now, Sally, who also served as churchwarden with Roger, is going to come and read from Mark's Gospel.
Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake."
It was Roger who first showed me this church. On the cool and dark November day when I came to be interviewed, he had been chosen. So we walked through the door, and before me was this very wonderful smiling figure with the little blue bag over his shoulder. None of us know what was in the little blue bag. And Roger and I walked around the building. Now, you might think that clergy have their minds on airy-fairy and high-powered things. Really, we were just looking at that point for damp patches and whether or not the roof would have to be done during my time. "What's the biggest problem we've got?" I asked Roger. "Dog poo in the churchyard," he replied. Round the building we went, and off to lunch with everyone else who was interviewing us. And Roger had clearly decided that the way to sort this all out was to charm the new vicar's wife, which indeed he did enormously successfully. Now, as there are different sorts of vicar, there are different sorts of church warden. And if all of this is a mystery to you, let me take you on a whistle-stop tour of the legalities of the Church of England. Church wardens are there to stop people like me becoming tyrants. They are all part of the checks and balances that make it all work. And at least in theory, the buildings are the church warden's responsibility before they are mine. There are different sorts of church warden and different sorts of vicar. There are the effective ones and the lazy ones. There are the noisy ones and the quiet ones. There are the ones who prefer to be dressed up at the front and the ones who would rather be hiding at the back. There are the ones who do the jobs that need doing and the ones who do the jobs that only people will notice. Now, it's reasonable to say that Chris Hargest and I are not blessed with patience. Chris and I want everything done yesterday or preferably the day before. Roger, by comparison, was so laid back he was horizontal, but he'd have done the job already while we were fussing about it. The last but one time I went to see him at home, he knew that the end was pretty close. And towards the end of our time together, Roger started to nod off in his bed. "Oh," I said, "it's just like when I preach." His eyes opened and he said, no, I like your sermons. And I said, "Well, you've only got to listen to one more." And the twinkle came back and he replied, "Well, at least I'll get to lie down for that one." Of all the things about this service that really speak to us of Roger, the hymn we sang earlier on, "Powerfully for Me Does the Job, Just as I am." For that was Roger. However grand you were, or however lowly, Whatever it was that needed doing or not doing, Roger was Roger, was Roger, was Roger. Whether he was with his family or with the bishop, whether he was playing pool or watching the football, whether he was emptying the bins in this place or waiting for any one of 100 workmen to not turn up, Roger was Roger, was Roger. And he had a very deep and very profound and very practical faith. The gospel reading we heard a few moments ago speaks of Jesus and the journey and others leaving the doorkeeper on the watch. Roger was the doorkeeper of this place for so long. Indeed, even today, he followed his life's tradition of arriving before you all to get it all ready and to make sure everything was as it should be. Roger's care, though, was not just for buildings and property, but above all else for people. In his very quiet, very unassuming way, he knew what was going on and who needed help. There would be a tap on the shoulder, and I was well advised to listen. Roger's humour was appalling. I mean, just dreadful, really. And yet, all of us remember those wonderful puns, those great moments we have shared together. I cannot walk past Cafe Kitali without expecting Roger's wave back. And we are all here today, as well as to give thanks, but to mark the absence that he leaves in our lives. He was, as far as possible, a gracious patient. Illness had come on quickly. Even from his bed, he managed to tease me that walking my dog at 10 in the morning was incredibly lazy. I used to walk mine at 5 a.m., he would say. And slightly naughtily, I retorted, "And look where it's got you." And he giggled and said, "Yes, stay in bed a bit longer." Roger knew what was coming, and I believe had no fear of it. His family nursed him with care and sacrifice and devotion. All of that devotion simply repaying the devotion that Roger had given them throughout his life. We are here so very grateful for Roger's time with us, for his memory, and for all that it will enliven in the days and years ahead. Those of us sat at the front who have had the privilege of working with Roger, particularly as churchwarden, give thanks to God for his unwavering support and his huge encouragement. Whenever I went to Roger with a mad idea, the answer was never no, but a grin and, well, let's see. We give thanks today, all of us, for this faithful doorkeeper of the Lord, for this gentleman who has gone ahead of us to the reward prepared for him. We draw close in love around those whom he loved the most, his dear Lorna, Amy, Judy, and all of his family. We give thanks to God for the gift Roger was, and in this week after Easter, we hand him with love and thanksgiving to our blessed and resurrected Lord. And we look forward one day, perhaps, to that familiar jingle of keys, maybe even that little blue bag, as Roger stands at the door and welcomes us to heaven. Rest well, Roger, and rise in glory.
And now we come to our prayers. Let us pray. God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image, to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks, Sir Roger, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good in his life, and for the memories that we treasure today. We especially thank you for the love he had as husband, brother, father, grandfather, and in so many other ways. For the quiet service that he offered in so many ways in this place, and for the rather dubious jokes that always cheered us up. God of mercy, Lord of life, you promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good this your servant Roger, as we also remember him. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. God of mercy, Lord of life, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy on all who mourn, especially Lorna, Amy, Judy, the grandchildren of Roger, and all who knew his love so much. Give them patient faith in times of darkness and strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. God of mercy, Lord of life, you are tender towards your children and your mercy is over all your works. Give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. God of mercy and Lord of life, entrusting into your hands all that you have made and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. And together we join in the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us, that we find in our order of service. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. We stand to sing another hymn chosen by Roger.
invite you now to remain standing for the prayer of commendation, after which we shall listen to Amy sing "It's Time to Say Goodbye." Following the blessing, the choir will sing the Nunc Dimittis, "Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace," as we carry Roger from this place. Please do turn towards the door as we bid him farewell, and then remain in church for refreshments. Please do take your refreshments and sit back in the pews as you wish. Let us commend the soul of our brother Roger to the care of Almighty God. You shared your life with us. God give eternal life to you. You gave your love to us. God give his deep love to you. You gave your time to us. God give his eternity to you. You gave your light to us. God give everlasting light to you. Go forth upon your journey from this world, O Christian soul, in the name of God the Father Almighty who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ who suffered death for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit who strengthens you, in communion with Blessed Mary, Nicholas, and all the saints, and aided by angels and archangels and all the armies of heaven. Roger, go forth, and may your portion this day be in peace, and your dwelling the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen. May God, in his infinite love and mercy, bring the whole church living and departed in the Lord Jesus to a joyful resurrection and the fulfillment of his eternal kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and all you love and pray for this day and always. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with the saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed from the dust of the earth, and unto earth shall we return. For so you ordained when you created us, saying, dust you are, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet weeping at the grave we make our song. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Acknowledge, we pray, Almighty God and Heavenly Father, our brother Roger, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Enfold him in the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.